in evaluation mode with Tyrod Taylor pretty much for his entire career. All this leaving a lot of people, a lot of the fans, to think that the team was in more of a rebuild mode this season. But, you know, also the word tanking was used. Do you guys remember
sure.
this?
Yeah,
we even asked Eric Wood about the tanking in September. Take a look.
It's tough, Eric, because this is a time of optimism and the season's about to start. Everyone's so excited. But with some of the players that you guys got rid of, there's been chatter, and I know you've heard it, this idea that the Bills are preparing for seasons to come rather than this season. Having heard that, how do you respond to that?
You know, I think it's smart for any organization to prepare for seasons to come, but, you know, I think we still have so much left here in Buffalo, talent-wise, that a tank isn't really in our vocabulary. No one's thinking that. We're focused on getting to a 1-0 this week. We play the Jets at home. And one of our goals is win all of our home games. So we're gearing up for this week, and we're not too concerned about all the outside chatter. You know, it's throughout my career here, we've had a lot of negative chatter, and that we've been close the last few years, 9-7, 8-8, 7-9. So we're right on the verge, and we just look to take that next step this year.
Early September, Bills tanking. Coach McDermott came to a team amidst a lot of turnover, lower than low expectations, and ended up taking them to the playoffs, breaking a 17-year drought. He's the one who did it in his first year after releasing, or not, he was even part of that, after a bunch of the best players on the team were released,
right,
and him having to sort of put it together. He, in my opinion, we've seen it, he's gotten the best out of his team week in, week out, executing efficiently. He's limited turnovers. They are +9, that is top 10 in the league. The Saints, the Rams, they have more turnovers. They're letting other teams make their mistakes, and it all starts with Sean McDermott and that culture that he's implemented, that, you know, Peter Schrager even talking about since he got the job all offseason, since Rex Ryan was the king in Buffalo up there. They protected their dirt. They bought in. They bounced back. They dropped 3 straight. Do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
When we did the Thursday night football game, and we were like, I don't know. They lost to the Jets. Yeah. I don't know. They dropped 3 straight in the middle of the season. They, as a team, were able to bounce back. And you think walking off that plane in Buffalo on Sunday, they're feeling themselves, feeling a little bit more confident after seeing what this means to the fans. There were a lot of doubts about this team going into the season, even in the middle of the season. And the one person who thought the Chiefs were going to beat them, or no, you called it after that 3-game drop that they were going to come back and beat the Chiefs.
Yeah.
Because of McDermott, you're right, that's the guy. And, Kay, he himself has this crazy story where he was fired as the Eagles defensive coordinator a few years ago and was, like, looking for a job. Carolina brings him on. He leads that Josh Norman defense. They go to the Super Bowl. They go 15-1. And then he doesn't get a job two years ago. Like, we went to the Super Bowl 15-1, and he doesn't get one of the jobs as the coordinator. Sean McVay had like a ticker tape parade in L.A. when he was hired, right? Last year we had all these people saying, what an amazing hire that the 49ers had with Kyle Shanahan.
Right.
I can't, you go back in the archive, I can't find anyone who Sean McDermott. And yet, here we are.
Here we are.
You know what, Kay? The Nathan Peterman thing. He decided to do that. I remember Peter and I were like, yeah, take your shot, change it up. It was a biblical disaster, and in the wake of that, that could have been the story of the Bills season.
Right.
We shouldn't have done that. We lost, missing the playoffs. They coached him up in spite of that disaster, still reaching the playoffs after that mess. He cleaned up the mess.
He corrected.
It's incredible.
Right.
A lot of resiliency, which I've learned from Peter Schrager. He's sort of had through his entire career, especially after what happened in Philadelphia following, you know, the late, great Jim Johnson over there. I feel like he went in there, didn't really have a chance, rebuilt what he had down there in Carolina, and now here he is, which is pretty amazing considering everything that's gone on in Buffalo. So he's underappreciated.
Good stuff.
Okay.
All right, so what I did yesterday is I reached out to the fans and I said, I want to give you guys an opportunity to send in photos and videos of fans that don't have a team in the hunt in the postseason because the season is over. So we got some people that sent us out some stuff. So I wanted to show you guys some love. And here's Mary. She says she purchased season tickets, of course. That's the game up against Green Bay. And, you know, she's a loyal fan. And I get it. You're out there supporting your team all year, and you're very disappointed at the end. And then moving on, we got the Packers and the Lions fans. They're out in the snow supporting their squad like they always
Packers
do.
Packers fans went through a lot this year.
Of course they did, as did the Lions, and here we are.
Lions fans thinking, oh, poor Packers.
Wah, wah. We got AT throwing up the horns. And listen, she's out there representing. She said, basically, the whole team is on IR. We get it. Yeah, the Texans, you guys deal with a lot from the very jump. Going
4-12, but hey, right, that's what she said.
She said, go Texans. And then Jeffrey, I just love everything about this. He said, you know, we had a terrible year, but I love the K. He got the knife in the mouth. He actually looks like a pirate in this photo. So listen, I appreciate it. And there were a ton more, so thank you for reaching out. So as I'm going through my Twitter feed, I was like, you know, what am I going to do? Am I going to just talk about the fans? I was like, you know what? I actually want to write a little something. So I wrote a poem for you guys. Right. So here we go. This is for you. This is for the pricey TV package you bought. This is for that mid-game football lesson that you taught. You know, you really know, well, they can return the two-point conversion.
Eight in the box. Right?
Yeah. This is for those freezing cold games that you attended. This is for that poser fan that you were introduced to and you befriended. This is for all the pregame tailgate antics. This is for that last second collapse that made you frantic. This is for those inappropriate curses. This is for the retro throwback jersey you purchased. This is for those off-season practices you watched. This is for all those new player names that you botched. This is for every autograph you got and saved. This is for the season tickets that you paid. This is for the colors that you bleed and not spreading your love willy-nilly. This is for every time you lifted up your cup and yelled, dilly dilly.
Yeah.
Listen, money, energy, love for your squad is the reason. I just wanted to say thank you. See you next season.
Yes.
I love that.
This is for you, Nate. This is for you.
I know it's going to be a long off season. You don't want to watch the postseason, but listen, we love you guys. Thank you for supporting us.
There we go. We are not finished. Great job by Nate there. You two are up in a little bit, but so are you guys out there watching. What's your underappreciated storyline of the week at hashtag GMFB? Let's get trending.